Okay, good afternoon, everyone. So welcome at our presentation about asset tracking in your supply chain. So I think we're one of the few, I think maybe the only live presenter on location next to Martijn. feels weird a bit. But yeah, we let's do our best and every business as we can and with the rules and to see what tonight will become extra rules. So we are going to talk about asset tracking in your supply chain, and I would like to make it as specific as possible to not to talk only high level and to throw some terms, but also make it to give some examples to make it also practical, simple to understand. So let us first introduce ourselves. I'm here myself, Jeremy Linders from Zitis, and also a colleague of mine, Rudy Sengers, business analyst, is present. Let's see, it's going automatically. There you go. Hij gaat automatisch. He's going very fast himself, so. Okay. Yeah, first a short introduction about Zitis. Let's see. So Zitis is a technology company, it's an international technology company. And we're basically focusing on identifying everything with an identifier. So basically, we identify goods. That's a big business of ours. Everything with a barcode, an RFID code, an ID, maybe a digital ID. We do that via different technologies. I will share some info about that in the next slide. We're a company with 1,200 people, based in 20-plus countries. And since 2017, we're part of Panasonic. They bought us, so. That gives us a few thousands of extra colleagues now. And the second slide, also the last slide about Zitis, is the slide which has a summary of our portfolio. This basically, here in this slide, you see everything we do. So Zitis is now present for 35 years, active for 35 years. And we're coming from the side from different technologies where we provide execution solutions. So we provide technologies like simple barcode scanning, voice picking, RFID, image ID also with cameras. And next on top of that, we provide mobile solutions. So solutions, first of all, for automatically printing and labeling. Also solutions for order picking, barcode scanning in the warehouse. And there basically what we do is we don't provide WMS systems, not TMS, not ERP systems, but we provide extra applications to optimize your process. Because our core business is making your process more optimal and optimize it. And that's something we do with technologies in the warehouse. Also what we do for Cetus Chronos. And to give you an example of Cetus Chronos, for instance, if you get a package from PostNL, when you put your signature on a mobile device, in that time you're putting your signature in our app. So there are a few thousands of delivery guys walking around with the mobile terminal and our app. We're also active in the field force automation and also in the in-store automation, like the employees who need to do stock counting, so need to have insights in the warehouse stock. Today I'm going to talk more about the upper side, so beyond Olympus and our Zeus visibility solutions. Whereas Olympus is basically our solution to connect all kinds of technologies and data streams and events together via standard open APIs. And those data we translate into visibility, like let's say presenting layers. And today I'm going to talk more about asset tracking. So having basically your assets visible to have oversights over your assets, but you could also expect visibility on orders or transport. You've heard about a lot of transport control towers, orders, supply chain control towers, a lot of those terms. And I'm going to focus about asset tracking, but also to explain what we see in what do we define as visibility. I mean, what's the difference between visibility on assets of orders or transport? So asset tracking your supply chain. And to start off with some examples, where you could think of these. There are a lot of different segments. So there are manufacturing companies, retail companies, healthcare, logistics, and even more different segments which you could define. And basically, within manufacturing, you could think of different crates, bins, tools, anything which is crucial to keep your production going. So those crates could be not expensive themselves, but they could be crucial for keeping your production process going, because they carry products which you eventually sell and use in your production process. Also, in the logistics process, you could think of tracking forklifts, tracking trailers, and of course, in healthcare, you could think of tracking wheelchairs, UV pumps, you name it. There are a lot of different assets, thousands of them, which are crucial for improving healthcare. Because you can imagine, if you're a patient and you're going into the hospital, somebody needs to find a wheelchair for you. Well, if that takes like half an hour, that's not a very good service. That's not very very good for you, and it's not, of course, very good for the employee themselves. Also, in retail, you could think of tracking crates, tracking containers, and you can go way further with some examples. To talk about asset tracking, and why should you track assets? Why is it important? Well, I'm going to talk also about business case drivers in a later slide to give you some examples for where to look at, where's the value for asset tracking. Basically, what we could do is, well, for instance, we know already about the asset. What is it? The height, width, depth, like the simple features of that asset. But mainly, we want to have answers on questions we have. We have problems which we want to solve. And those questions could be, okay, where is it? Where was it? How long has it been there? Also, for certain reasons, you want to know where it is. For instance, in a hospital, if you have a patient right in front of you and you need a wheelchair as quickly as possible, or if you're in logistics and you need one forklift driver to pick up a certain crate, and you want to know, okay, where are those forklifts or where are those crates even? So you can come up with a lot of more examples. Well, to look at examples of implementation, and maybe really good to check based on time, if you can warn me if I'm spending a lot of time. First, I'm going to start to look at asset tracking in your supply chain. And if you're talking about asset tracking in your supply chain, you could think of this example. If you have a carrier, like a metal trolley, who is carrying products, items, any goods, that crate might go to different stakeholders. It might go to another transport company, to another logistics company, to a customer of yours, and eventually it will come back. It's a returnable asset. That asset needs to come back. You need to have it. You don't want to invest in new assets all the time, because otherwise you're losing a lot of money. And it's oftentimes it's difficult for companies to really track those assets. Because mainly all companies, let's say most companies, have an ERP system, some have a WMS system, TMS system, but a lot of systems are really focused within the four walls, unless the TMS, of course. Where we focus on is beyond the four walls, to connecting all business events, like, okay, an asset is loaded, in transit, received, and any business events you could think of. We connect those events and share it not only with you, but also with the supply chain partners, to make sure you have like one platform which combines all the data, and where you can say, okay, customer or stakeholder or partner, here you have your own credentials, you can log in and you can see the information which we want to share with you. So there's no more emailing or calling. Of course, there will always be emailing and calling, but less, because people know where the assets are. They don't have to call, okay, where is this asset? I cannot find it, or they are carrying these goods. I need to know where it is. No, you can just see it into the platform. To give some visuals also, you can imagine if you have a global supply chain, you want to know globally where those assets are, and you don't want to be limited to a certain country. And this is one example where you could show those assets on like a Google Maps map. And of course, this looks interesting, but the question is, what are you going to do with it? It might be important that you need to search for a specific ID, that you type in a specific ID and you see, okay, it's in that country. You can also show it in reports, of course, then you immediately have the right information. But you can also drill down to more specific detailed maps. So this is an example. Let's see. This is an example on a building level when you have a lot of buildings together. You want to know more specifically where the asset is. And if you go one step further, you can even look within your location where that asset is. And of course, you can only know what is being registered. So if it's not registered, that it is, for instance, scanned into this room or passed an RFID reader, you don't know where it is. And if you're a global supply chain company who is moving a lot of assets globally, then of course this is not enough. But if you're a hospital, for instance, you just want to know, okay, where are those wheelchairs within my facility or within my two buildings, for instance. To give you one example, again, about the metal trolley, these could be like some different attributes about that trolley, which you might want to know, or maybe you want to have a trigger, for instance, when the asset is shipped to a certain customer or a certain location, or you want to know, okay, I want to have an alert, for instance, every 3 months, because I need to review that asset for maintenance or for inspection or for cleanup. And also, yeah, there could be other important attributes about that asset which you want to know. And there, again, the more information which is being registered, the more information we can show. This is basically an example of one report which can be shown to companies depending on their questions and needs, of course. Again, some examples about these segments. I'm going to talk shortly about the healthcare, then manufacturing, then logistics. So in healthcare, I already explained a bit about wheelchairs, for instance, but also beds could be an example which I want to track. And also another example is, for instance, tracking the right instruments for the operation rooms. You can imagine if a surgeon is ready for an operation, then he needs 100% to have the right items on the right location on the right time. They cannot waste any second. So that way, teams like facility management or logistics or medical devices department needs to put the right assets on the right location for the surgeon's team or for the nurses to get. Also, the same accounts for, I already talked about wheelchairs, the same accounts for UV pumps. And basically, it's maybe for different reasons. It could be, at the end, for improving healthcare. But to be more specific, it could be for having more grip on the maintenance part, better asset management, less frustration on nursing level. And there are a lot of different parties involved which have other benefits by asset tracking. Another example is in manufacturing. So manufacturing is, of course, one of the key points is to keep production going and not to stop production. Also, one of the earlier slides or earlier presentations said, well, if you stop production, it costs a lot of money. It depends, of course, on your company. But production for a manufacturing company is crucial. And for that, you need to have the right assets on the right time. One example is a customer which has those crates, and in those crates are items, products of theirs, and those crates needs to be on the right production line at the right time, because otherwise it stops, and you basically have forklift drivers just moving around and seeing, okay, what can I do, instead of being proactively assigned to a specific task to pick up a specific asset to put on a specific location. Also, I'm already explaining the process, but it could also be for planning reasons and just making your operation more efficient. If you know exactly where everything is, you can better assign specific tasks to specific forklift drivers or employees. And all to improve production efficiency and customer service. The third one is logistics. I'm not used to presenting with with this thing on, so it's a bit tricky. But an example in logistics. So I already talked about trailers, tracking trailers, and to give you a visual about that, for that is this one. Here you see a site, basically first a photo of the complete site. So it's a big one with hundreds of trailers parked. And here you see basically digitally the view of that same site. And in this specific example, are the trailers also tagged with an RFID tag, so that way we know exactly the location. And of course, if they are not tagged with a specific RFID tag, you might only know, for instance, if it's in this region or that region, if you have a register point on the left side or right side. Somewhere something needs to be registered, could even be manually an employee typing in, okay, this asset is on that location. And also to emphasize, we're not the TMS or WMS with locations in it, but this is really focusing on location services, also real-time locationing solutions. RTLS is maybe also a more known term, but that's more on the technology side. Also, it could be important to have that information for better collaboration with suppliers. So for instance, for having better yard management to know exactly where are the trailers from different transport companies on my site right now. Could also be by giving them a simple terminal or a simple badge in the, at the beginning when they enter the site, and then from then on till they leave, you know exactly where they are. All to improve efficiency and for other reasons which are a lot, and to make sure there's not too much text on this slide. The last example is for retail. You can imagine for retail, they have a lot of crates, of those plastic crates, and of those containers. And when you're talking about asset tracking in those examples, you can imagine it's a way too expensive to tag them with active RFID, for instance, or like those technologies, because there are thousands of those crates. But that way, you could also track those assets by simply using your existing barcode scanning system, but just making sure that that business event, that scan, also triggers an event in a certain platform. Maybe you already have a solution which can provide it. If not, well, please call us, of course. This is also for efficiency reasons, but also to improve customer satisfaction, to be able to better meet the needs of your customer and not to need to search for containers, for instance, at staging. When you have a warehouse and you're staging 10 containers for a truck going to a store, you're missing one, and then you have to say to your team, okay, team, drop everything. We need to search for that one trailer. That is the case for some companies still. And you can say, okay, but that's chaotic. That's probably not true, but it is. There are still situations where that needs to happen. Combining technologies, also to give you a few examples and to give you some information about technologies, not to go into too much detail. Technologies which can be used is RFID, active RFID, passive RFID, but also barcode scanning. And I cannot explain in the first meeting or in the first minute to a customer, okay, this is the technology you need, because it all depends on the information you want to have. And the questions which we need to raise is, okay, how often do you want to know the location of that asset, and how accurate needs it to be? And based on all that information, we are going to check which technology might suit best. Because you can imagine, the more accurate it is and the more often it registers events at more points, the more expensive it will be. And of course, we're talking about creating value and looking for value to bring. And if you're putting all the value into a very expensive technology, yeah, of course, there's no business case left. So you have to be very specific about that. And we're here also to challenge the customers in that part. Well, a few technologies are these. I mentioned them before, like the passive technologies, and we call them passive RFID as one example, but also barcode scanning. Simple barcode labels is also a passive technology. You have to scan it, and then it registers something. And of course, those ones are less expensive than active RFID examples. If you see another table which we made is this one. So here you see Bluetooth Low Energy, Wi-Fi technology, ultra wideband, GPS. You might have heard of them, or a lot of them, which are great technologies for the right business case. So you cannot always say, okay, ultra wideband is most accurate because it's it can give the location on 20 centimeters specific, while there is no business case for 20 centimeters and it might not even be needed. So for instance, in healthcare, a lot of hospitals say it's enough for us to know if we know that the asset is, for instance, in that room. We don't need to know if the asset is exactly in this corner, 10 centimeters away from the wall, for instance. There's no need for that. Let's look at the business case drivers to give you an idea about that. And some drivers may be for production is, of course, to make sure that the production process doesn't stop. On one hand, reduce the risk for it to happen, but also specifically making sure that there are no costs involved. Basically, it could be by making sure the production process doesn't stop. That, of course, that reduces costs, but also making sure that your team doesn't need to search for assets that much. Because search time is a waste of time, unless it's limited to a minimum. The other parts for the logistics process, especially for a logistics service provider, is their core business. So the logistics process needs to go on, and as faster and as smooth as it goes, the better it is for the company. Less search time, I already mentioned it. Less stock is also an important one, because not only in healthcare, but also in retail and probably also in logistics, companies are buying extra assets to making sure they don't have, get out of stock. They don't have out of assets, basically. That their assets are on location at the customer site or logistics company, partner company, and then they need some assets, then they say, okay, we're going to invest in extra assets, and then basically they have way too much assets in their supply chain, which involves a lot of cost. The other one, efficient operations management. If you know the exact location of forklifts, it could be a valuable one for some companies, and better collaboration with suppliers and customers. You can share information about those assets in your supply chain. Then choosing focus for visibility, because in these sessions today, we're talking about connectivity and visibility, and the term visibility is thrown a lot by a lot of companies. And what is visibility? Well, basically, if you translate visibility or you select other words for visibility, is seeing something. Okay, what the question is then, what do you want to see? And we define it as different names. You can have, of course, transport visibility, as they call it, order visibility, basically seeing where your orders are, seeing where your trucks are, but also you could see where your assets are. That's why we call this, you could call it asset visibility, we call it asset tracking. Those are basically just words which could be used in the same sentence. But also it could be interesting, for instance, if you are a brand owner, to know exactly where your products are and to know exactly where the products are produced and to share it with the end consumer, to making sure that if they scan a QR code, that they know exactly where it has been made, for marketing reasons, of course, a lot of times. Well, this was the example about asset tracking. And about asset tracking, what mainly needs to be managed is the location of the asset, the status of the asset. Because if an asset is occupied, of course you need to search for another asset. So you need to know, is it available, is it reserved, or if it has another status. And also the third one is alerts. So it might be important for your company to know exactly, okay, if an alert is going to that location, could be the wrong location, that you want to be alerted, that you want to have an email or an SMS, to making sure that you put the right decisions into place to make sure that the process goes on as efficient as possible. Another example is transport visibility. This is an example of a dashboard which we provide by connecting all different TMS systems and different technologies which companies provide. So if you have like hundreds of transport companies which are picking up goods, you can imagine they are not using all the same TMS systems or the same applications. What we then do is we say, okay, you just keep those systems in place. They might have some extra functionalities which could be enough for you, but if you want to go the extra mile, if you want to have information about these points, we can provide one place where you have complete oversight of your transport activities. Not only your transport activities, but also the transport activities from companies which are picking up goods from your site. Another example is order visibility. And also to give a few references, this is, for instance, a case what we do for Marks & Spencer, a retailer in England and France. So we give them full visibility on purchase orders, basically. They start up with a purchase order specifically for fresh food with a short lifetime, and we are tracking that those orders completely during the complete supply chain. So when it left the supplier's production facility, it triggers an event. When it's received at a warehouse, it triggers an event. So when it's picked up by a transport company, it triggers an event. And that way they have complete overview of the end-to-end supply chain, and we provide real-time dashboards for that to have view on the KPIs, on how are your stakeholders performing, to know exactly where inventory in your supply chain is, and also to keep track of your orders. You could even track aggregation levels to know exactly, okay, this container contains these IDs and these boxes contains these specific single items, for instance. Another example about basically visibility is visibility on your products. And as we see it, visibility starts a lot with track and trace. So that's why we are using the term track and trace a lot within logistics when it comes to visibility, because we're tracking and tracing logistic events. We're tracking business events in your supply chain, which then gives you visibility. Of course, you could translate it then to a dashboard or to a report or to anything, and then it gives you visibility. But this is called then product traceability. And what we mean by product traceability is tracking, tracing the product when it's produced and exactly knowing which components are involved. And then finding following the life of the product. And at the end, when a consumer wants to check if the product is original or not, it could scan a barcode or a label or RFID tag. An example where we do this is Louis Vuitton. Louis Vuitton has some high-end bags. Let's not say expensive, but high-end. And those high-end bags, of course, need to be authentic. Consumers want to make sure that if they buy a Louis Vuitton bag, that it's 100% a Louis Vuitton bag, and not a bag with an LV logo produced in China for 10 bucks less, for instance. So what they do here is, at the end, consumers are able to scan the label on the products and to see the life of the Louis Vuitton bags. Maybe also to add another example, which is quite popular these days. You see more and more information specific about fish. I think it was recently also on one of the media sites that another fish company implemented this to give a view to consumers about the production locations about their fish. Now I'm not specifically a guy who goes into a shop and then scans the barcode of a fish product, but it's mainly also for maybe for marketing reasons, but also if you have a lot of consumers which do want to know exactly, okay, which certificates belong to this product and is it indeed produced on that location and what are the conditions, and they want to have that information. And this is becoming also more and more hot topic. Then the last one which I want to share already is about legislations, because either visibility or track and trace could be driven by an internal question you may have as a company. You want to have visibility on specific assets or transport for different reasons, because maybe orders are being sent to the wrong locations, or it's not just simply not optimal in your supply chain. It could also be that your transport companies are doing what they are supposed to do, but making mistakes, and you don't know why, because you don't have oversight over them. Or it could be that you're losing assets or searching for assets, and therefore have that internal question. In this case, legislations are the drive for visibility and for track and trace. And to give you a few examples, which are very relevant for now, is the medical device regulation. So starting from next year, a specific class in medical devices, you could say things like pacemakers, implants, they all need to have a unique identifier. They need to have a unique ID serialized by the manufacturer. And that ID needs to be track and traced throughout the complete supply chain, so that in the end, if you're laying in the hospital and you have a operation and someone is giving you a pacemaker or an implant, that they register that. And then later on, when something might happen or might become known about that implant, which is negative, then they need to be able to recall all those implants and need to be sure which patients have exactly these implants. And for that, they are tracking and tracing it throughout the supply chain. We're helping them. We're providing the platforms, but also the mobile applications to do so. And also another example is the Falsified Medicines Directive. It's about medicines. Maybe some have heard of it, some have not. But now we have 2,000 pharmacies in the Netherlands, and they're all scanning each individual medicine pack to deactivate them, basically, in an external database. So to make sure that if you get a medicine now at the pharmacy that is legal and produced exactly at the right manufacturer's location. And also for that, production needs to be sure that it has a unique ID and it's being tracked throughout the supply chain. And some supply chain partners are scanning it in between to make sure, okay, is this indeed a legal pack? Is this active in an external database? Another example is the Tobacco Products Directive, also because in the tobacco industry there was a lot of, there was a big gray market. So I think it was also in the news a few weeks ago that that another tobacco company, an illegal tobacco company, was found in the Netherlands. I don't know exactly where it was, but it was somewhere in the Netherlands. Might also be in other countries. For the people who are watching, I think you already know how big the issue is in your company. But it is a big issue, and therefore the European Commission, they also made a legislation about tobacco products. So tobacco products are now being track and traced throughout the supply chain. And again, the manufacturer is giving it a unique ID, and then the wholesaler is scanning it at receival, and then it's scanning it at outbound dispatching. Then again, at the logistics service company is doing the same. And then before it's sent to retail, it's also scanned to say, okay, these tobacco products are going to that specific retail shop, to make sure that the complete supply chain, well, let's say not the complete supply chain, but the biggest part of supply chain is covered, to make sure there are not illegal tobacco products in the supply chain, which maybe are more damaging than the legal ones. Also in agroscience and different markets, legislations could be the drive for track and trace. What we do in this part is you see another example of another report. This one is more simple, to provide a report to show you the needed information for this legislation for track and trace, real time connected to external databases. So in this case, there were different connections needed to databases, for instance, to the EMVS and NMVS for the medicines, but also to the EU router for the tobacco products, but also to the EudaMed database, which is needed for the medical devices. Well, those are actually only four connections, but also in one case, we provide like these real-time dashboards for a big retailer with hundreds of suppliers and logistics companies. Because what we do is we connect all events and we share it with different companies, and the customer, of course, decides what they want to share with the customer with the companies. because we are 35 years already active in integration and building interfaces, we are highly experienced in supporting that and making sure that these kind of projects are actually a success, and not to say only, okay, here you have a dashboard, here you have a platform, now good luck with connecting to that platform, making sure the data gets there. No, we help in that, and we have teams in 20 plus countries, also with engineers, architects, and the people who are really needed for such an implementation. Then to end with a slogan which we apply a lot on these topics, it's basically think big, start small, and scale fast. And what we say by that is you need to look at the bigger picture, you need to look at your complete supply chain, and basically look at your ideal situation, and then say, okay, there and there and there, we have points where visibility maybe, might not, or might provide value for your company. And then you could say, okay, we have a business case, it brings value to us, we're going to focus specific on assets or orders or transport or no matter what. And then start small, focus on, for instance, connecting one supplier instead of hundreds in the beginning. Start with connecting one supplier or a few, and then seeing what benefit it brings to you. And then when you're in the process, you've implemented a few suppliers, then you need a solution who is also flexible and being able to scale up very quickly. That's also our advice, and that's also how we work in implementations with companies who have hundreds of suppliers or logistics partners, for instance. So I think an interesting picture to end with. These are my my contact details for questions. I can imagine people might have questions. I think the biggest part of us is watching online. Maybe we already saw some questions, and otherwise we will... Okay, fair. Great. Yeah, we try to make it as specific as possible with some examples, and hopefully it's easy to listen to. If you have any questions, please feel free to contact us, to email, to call, just to maybe just spar or brainstorm about a certain topic, and see if we can challenge you if there's value or not. Thank you for your time.